Hello everyone, my name is Debarpa Ganguly and today I would like to focus on Daniel Defoe's Robinson Crusoe. Now, before going into the details of Robinson Crusoe, I would like to offer certain commentaries on each of the chapters and sometimes a chunk of chapters so that we can have an understanding of what is going on into the text. Now, the text opens with chapter 1 entitled I Go to Sea. Now, this chapter is very interesting because this chapter sheds some light on the impetus of creating Robinson Crusoe and also provides us with a backstory. Now, the idea of Robinson Crusoe came to Defoe from a real life person whose name was Alexander Selkirk, who in a fit of anger had himself put ashore on an island, which was a deserted island. And earlier Selkirk had got into a fight with another crew member, and he had put himself into a deserted island towards the outskirts of Chile. Now, when he realized the ramifications of his actions, he tried to plead with his crew members to come back to save him, but it was too late and he was marooned for 4.5 years on that island. Now, when he was later rescued, it is said that Selkirk lost his ability to speak because he had found no one to speak to for the 4.5 years, but later he regained his speech. But what happened with this was that Selkirk's story became very, very popular in England, and it became the subject matter of different articles, including one by Sir Richard Steele in The Englishman. Now, this was actually considered to be an adventure story, and certain people have said, certain critics have argued that Defoe himself once interviewed Alexander Selkirk, though it is debatable, but one thing we can agree on is that Defoe knew the story of Alexander Selkirk. And how do we know it? Because many of Selkirk's experiences are actually mirrored in Defoe's book. For instance, Selkirk fed on turnips, fish, goat's meat, he became overrun with cats, and he had to use his ingenuity to survive. Now, all of these things are similar with Defoe's experience, Crusoe's experience in the novel. Even Crusoe's name is not Crusoe, it's Robinson Crusoe. Similarly, Selkirk's name is not Selkirk, but it's Alexander Selcraig, S-E-L-C-R-A-I-G. So you can see that there are certain parallels. But one of the clues to the basic idea of the novel is given in the first chapter, and that's why this chapter is very important. Now, you'll see if you read the text that Crusoe's father admonishes his son to stay in the middle station of life, that is, not to become too adventurous and not to become too sedentary. Now, what is this middle station of life? Now, Crusoe tells us that this station had the fewest disasters and was not exposed to so many vicissitudes as the higher or lower part of mankind. But as we see that Crusoe's pride would not have it, and he would venture into the adventurous side of mankind and not remain in the middle station. So Crusoe, like the protagonist of many of the Greek tragedies, kind of suffers from his own hubris. And we see that his hubris is accordingly punished in the text. Now, often during his confinement on the island, you will see that Crusoe is reminded of his father's advice and kind of rues his own impulsiveness. Moreover, his father's pronouncement that Crusoe might be happy if he would stay at home, but if he goes abroad, he will be the most miserable wretch that was ever born. It becomes a very proleptic statement, a very prophetic statement, which foreshadows Crusoe's later predicament. Now, the father's predictions coming true sooner than Crusoe had expected is also a case of chance and coincidence in the novel. That is, his first boat founders and Crusoe makes solemn vows in his time of trouble. But as soon as the trouble gets over, he forgets his vows and we see that he is back to sea once again. So this is Crusoe's first attempt of going against his own god, going against his own words. And you will see that throughout the rest of the novel, we will see a constant contemplation of Crusoe's relationship to God and how much God is punishing him for his wicked ways. Now in chapter 2 and chapter 3, that entitled I Am Captured by Pirates and I Escape from the Sally Rover respectively, we see the development in a similar and yet different way. That is, his father's predictions keep on continuing, and his through his various misfortunes, and among the misfortunes, what is significant is that he gets captured by Moors and we see his subsequent enslavement. Moreover, his enslavement is correlated to his pride, in that he was too ashamed to accept his failure, and his pride drove him onward to further adventures which resulted in his capture. Now you will see that in chapter 2 we are coming across Crusoe's sense of materialism, as he is able to turn 40 pounds into 300 pounds, that is, in a profit. Now this aspect of Crusoe's character has been greatly emphasized later when he is marooned on the island, because he collects every possible type of goods, some of which will be no use to him, as is understood. But Crusoe's materialism and a pseudo-capitalism, if I may call it, has been the subject matter of much adverse criticism, and the Marxist critics have been very ruthless towards Crusoe, as we shall see later if we have time. Now in chapter 3 we see his escape from his enslavement, and it is here that we for the first time glimpse into Crusoe's ingenuity, a quality which will be necessary for his survival on the island. The chapter also gives us hints into Crusoe's relationship with Friday later on, as it emphasizes his ability to manipulate people and to seemingly win their loyalty, as he is able to completely subject Jury into his own will. Now many modern critics have objected to the patronizing impact that Crusoe has to his inferiors, who are obligated to him. But others have seen Crusoe simply as a blazing opportunist. Now we are not going into a character analysis of Crusoe, but however I am mentioning in tidbits certain interesting factors about Crusoe. Now in chapters 4 and 5, I become a Brazilian planter and I go on board in an evil hour respectively. We see that the materialistic strain is still being continued to be emphasized, especially in chapter 4 when he begins to acquire more land, more goods and more money. He realizes that he is coming into that middle station of life which his father advised him to attain in England. Now, as he prospers, he begins to regret the fact that he sold Jury, not because of his feelings for the boy, but because he could have been useful as a slave. Now, consequently, as soon as he has the means, he buys himself a slave to work for him. Thus, in spite of Crusoe's seemingly religious nature, apparently both the author and his fictional character embrace the concept of slavery. Now, this too shall become a very problematic aspect in the novel later on when we discuss. Now, Defoe's own attitude, if we look at it, is at least ambivalent, if not hypocritical in that morally. But, he spoke out against people who barter baubles for the souls of men, and yet he invested heavily in the slave trade and maintained that it was the most useful and most profitable trade of any part of the general commerce of the nation. Now, there is a sense of irony in the novel, because in Crusoe's main objection to his plantation, that is his isolation, the fact that he has nobody to converse with but now and then his neighbor, we shall see that later the most pleasing thing to Crusoe is the sound of a human voice after about 20 years of hearing no human sounds. Now, unable to be content with his fortune and ever desiring to acquire more wealth, Crusoe once again tempts fate by planning to go to Africa to buy slaves for himself and for neighboring planters. Now, thus his materialism is directly correlated with his later plight. Now, what happens is Crusoe continues to bemoan his isolation on his plantation. Once he is shipwrecked and marooned on the island, he realizes that whatever one's fate is, it can always be worse. In chapters 6, 7 and 8, entitled I Furnish Myself with Many Things, I Build Many Fortresses, the journals part 1 to 5 respectively, we see a very significant development. For instance, the qualities which most readers admire in the novel are illustrated in these chapters. Here we see a man pitted against forces of nature and forced to utilize his ingenuity in order to survival, in order to survive. The instinct for survival, therefore, becomes the strongest of all instincts for Crusoe himself, and as psychologists have suggested that, or even Darwin has suggested, survival of the fittest. So the instinct for survival is a major instinct in all of us. And in these chapters we can see that Crusoe is relegated to his most basic existence, his most elemental, most foundational sense of existence. Thus the appeal of these chapters is in the simple narration of how he is being able to survive, and in his narration of the things that he is able to salvage from the ship. Now, Crusoe's materialism is further emphasized as he discovers some money which is of absolutely no value to him. And he recognizes this very soon because, however, he is unable to overlook the money and he ends up taking it with him. Even when he contrasts the good and evil of his situation, he approaches this as a man of profit and loss. In terms of profit and loss, that is in materialistic terms, in utilitarian terms, he keeps on listing each one as one would enter into a ledger of his credits and debits, of his profits and losses. He is seemingly comforted by the fact that his credits are greater than his debits. After all his comrades died in shipwreck and he is the sole survivor. Chapter 8 is a long and difficult chapter because in this chapter, Crusoe goes back in time and reiterates all the things that have happened to him since he landed on the island. Now, there are a few things which are narrated and there is nothing highly significant in terms of the entire novel. The main purpose of the journal was to keep track of time, but by the end of this chapter he is running out of ink and therefore rendering this purpose to be not that useful. In chapters 9, 10 and 11, I sow my grain, I travel quite across the island and I am very seldom idle respectively. We see that Defoe continues to show us how ingenious Crusoe is, as he is able to master the elements and is able to plant 2 crops a year and is also able to master the art of basket weaving in order to have some containers for his harvest. In chapter 10, you will see that Crusoe is surrounded with the bounty of the island, but he is anguished at his condition and he says, "My very heart would die within me to think of the woods, the mountains, the deserts I was in, and how I was a prisoner locked up with the eternal bars and bolts of the ocean in an uninhabited wilderness without redemption. Now this posits a central question, the question of Adam and Eve. They too were in a similar garden which was bountiful, but they were punished due to their aspirations and their defiance of their God. Crusoe, on the other hand, was banished to an early paradise because of the wicked, cursed, abominable life he had led in the earlier parts of his life, in the earlier parts of his day. So you can see it's a reverse tale of the fall. In chapter 11, Crusoe is seen continuing his various duties, and he's involved with his survival, but he's beginning to expand on the numbers of the things that he can accomplish. By the end of this chapter, Crusoe has been on the island for 3 full years. Here I stop with this lecture, and I'll continue in the next one. Thank you, everybody.